Thank you for the nice introduction. And I have to bring you back a little bit to the technicality of our subject, although I definitely share the holistic approach, which is true. So I'm more dealing with the technical part of data, but I'm also dealing with standardization, and standardization brings us back to all the human issues, because this lonely guy there that doesn't want to play with others is also a participant in standardization processes. We doesn't want everything, so I think we are also in this field. Maybe a little bit, because I was asked to present also from my own side. Besides working a lot with Building Smart on IFCs, I'm also running a consulting company, AEC3, in Munich, Germany, so where we deal with a lot of BIM-related subjects as a consultant. And I'm also coming more from the BIM side, from the building side, now getting more drawn into the infrastructure world. But today I will focus on my work, mainly together with Building Smart, on defining IFC for infrastructure. What brought me into this was some work I did earlier with construction companies and trying to understand their processes and their demands. And they always told me that this kind of differentiation or dividing we do between buildings and infrastructure is somehow superficial, because at the end they have to pour the same kind of concrete or the same rebars and so on, regardless whether it's a wall in a building or it's a substructure of a road or it's a pier of a bridge. So I think we definitely have to take a little bit more holistic approach on this information for construction, and don't try to go too much into the silos of buildings and linear infrastructures and bridges and so on. So what I think the challenges we have now is to get these worlds more closely together. And at the end, I think we have to talk about the same kind of material data, scheduling data, also sometimes product data, regardless whether it's buildings or infrastructure works. And the other thing which became clear when you look at this broader perspective is the importance of standards. Because I think we will not have solutions or technical solutions, software solutions covering all and everything of this very broad perspective. So we need standards that enable software and thereby also humans to interoperate. And I think that brings me now to the core of today's talk, to talk about scope of standards and standardization development for infrastructure works. And when we look, those work can actually happen, then we see some organizations which I think have been introduced in detail yesterday. I think there were several presentations from key participants in these organizations, mainly Building Smart and OGC, let's say for the classical BIM and GIS world. But we also work strongly together with ISO, the International Standardization Organization, and there I think there's at least three different committees that have to somehow get integrated into it. These numbers are sometimes quite cryptic, so maybe I should explain a little bit. So the first one, SC13, that's the Committee for Information for Construction Works, which is part of the Technical Committee for Construction Works or for buildings in general in ISO. In the middle, this is a more or less the mechanical world. It's all these people that defined, for example, STEP, and the standards in the mechanical industry, which is still important because we have to build with a lot of machinery and we also have a lot of equipment in our buildings. And then, of course, on the right side, TC211, which is the ISO committee for GIS. I would like to concentrate a bit on the work of Building Smart today, although I think that also have been made clear yesterday that we are doing it together with all these groups here. And within Building Smart, I think we have seen a move towards infrastructure during the last years. I think it started back in 2010, 2011 at the summit in Abu Dhabi. I think that was the first time to create kind of interest group called Open Infra, which brought together state clients, construction companies, and others to talk about the need for infrastructure standards. I think it became then a little bit more formal to become an infrastructure room in about 2012. And although when you observe how Building Smart develops in these interest groups, I think it's now the fastest growing one. So last, like we had our meeting in Toronto last month, and it was the biggest attended room of all. And it has now its own structure. There's a steering committee or called Infra Room, trying to manage and the kind of work that has to be carried out. And there are several active projects or project in preparations to take the work further. For example, this the different boxes all stand for a kind of effort to do within this infrastructure side of Building Smart. One very practical one is to guarantee some future of land XML, which is, I think, a kind of de facto standard used by many, not really maintained in the currently. There's some cooperation between OGC and Building Smart to keep it alive and do some maintenance on it. It's mainly supported by Finland right now within Building Smart. They have an own national program called InfraBIM. And there's now also a publication, documentation, everything for all people that want to use Lent XML in the meantime. There's quite some history in talking about bridges, which I think will now reappear on the surface again, and I will show a little bit more about this. What I want to concentrate today is on the alignments. I mean, alignment as being the central part for all linear infrastructure works. I think there has to be a common agreement now that these alignments have to be defined first, and I will focus on this. But then, of course, the next logical step is about roads and maybe railways, and there are some very active works going on in Korea right now, and I might introduce a little bit on that as well. So this brings me now to alignment as being the first active project for enhancing Building Smart standards, in particular IFC, for capturing infrastructure works. And when we look at alignment, I think it clearly shows that we are right in the middle between BIM and infrastructure, or GIS, because alignment is very strongly related to digital terrain. It has to somehow follow the terrain. It's very closely related to earthworks and other things, and maybe in the future to telematics and so on, to have machinery going along this alignment. And in order to tackle this, which will be the basis for all other vertical developments for infrastructure like road design, bridge design, tunneling, maybe dams, maybe even grid lines, we have to first get a clear understanding of alignment. And so the project to define this alignment is now active, it's running, and it has a strong collaboration with OGC that have a parallel project working on it called InfraGML. And we agreed to define a common conceptual model, or at least the agreements on how to understand the information, how to structure it is common, although the realization will then be specific. So when we looked into alignment, I think we have to face a kind of traditional approach which engineers have used over the last maybe decades, which is reducing the geometric complexity of 3D alignments into a horizontal and a vertical profile. And although maybe looking further and looking ahead, we would envision that this will have to give way to a clear operation on 3D alignments, this way of structuring the information is also, how to say, enshrined in regulations. Most of the road authorities, prescribe this way of working. So when we had to define our approach, I think we agreed that we have to still support this 2D alignment approach, but together with a 3D alignment for future works. And of course, it's possible to generate a 3D alignment from the 2D information, or 2D plus vertical profiles. And there are, of course, many previous work, like LandXML or OXTAR, which is a German standard on this information, which we had analyzed before we then made a proposal for the IFC alignment. In order to realize such a project, I think we need sponsors and support. And we were able to receive this support. First, I think maybe someone from Reiswaterstadt is in the room, I could guess. They are one of the supporters of this alignment project. The other one is from Sweden, Traffic Faircat. And then I think we probably will hear from Suhail, maybe later some presentations. There's also a European project called VCON, which looks into future standards and developments for roads. So together we set up a project team. We integrated OGC into that, vice versa. I think we are also part of the Lenten Infra project in OGC to work together on it. One of the probably important decisions was that we established an international expert panel. So we invited road and rail experts around the world to review it or to be part of it, running webinars or web conferences every month. And this expert panel really proved extremely helpful because we get a broad perspective on this, not only from Europe, but also from America and Asia and Australia. And apparently they have some different requirements sometimes. For example, we learned about a very specific Japanese spiral, which probably is needed for Shinkansen, but not everywhere else. So I think it's quite important to really engage with the experts on these endeavors. Since it is a real funded and contracted project, it has a project plan. I think we now, end of November, beginning of December, are very close to finishing a version one of it, and we'll then have 2 or 3 months more in spring to verify it and make some minor additions, which will then lead to version 1.1. And to a rollout plan of this work for 2015. And as we do it in general, and this is, I think, standard building smart knowledge on how to proceed with these projects, is we always start with a process analysis. We try to understand the business process of the domain. So this is one of the examples where we try to analyze broadly the kind of working on all the collaboration processes between the various stakeholders and also identify their information sharing needs. These are these little orange boxes. And the next phase, we then looked into these boxes to see what kind of alignment information is actually required, because all of this has some kind of level of details. It's not always the same. And that follow this building smart work also know that it's called IDM or information delivery manuals to understand process and data. So then the next work we did is we looked into all of these orange boxes which were numbered, and then we came to a long list. And don't ask you to read this, it's just saying it's a long list, which then tries to identify exactly this information exchange points. I think I heard the new terminology is drop points. I probably still want to call it exchange points for now. And they always have a sender and a receiver. They have two parties that have to agree on the need of this information. It always has a purpose. So information exchange should not be free of purpose. It has to be a purpose. And the purpose drives the content and the details of this. So we were analyzing it and then came to different level of definitions. And after some of a summary, I think we identified at the end four level of definitions that then have to be incorporated into the alignment model. So we ended up with this kind of backbone or meta schema, considering alignment as being horizontal and vertical, and combined being a 3D alignment. And then we had a long debate among the experts, because apparently in different places in the world, alignments are defined slightly differently. Some taking segments, saying start point, direction, end point, or length. Others talk always about virtual point of intersections, trying to find where these two tangents meet somewhere and define the alignment from there. And those are either or decisions. You can always convert one into the other, but you have to decide what you take. And after a long debate, we settled on defining the segments and not the VPIs. Although we will prove that the VPIs can be generated from segment information all the time. But that's one of the essence of standardization. You have to die one dead. I mean, you cannot try to incorporate everything. So I think we're now quite happy. We defined this conceptual schema, which will be the baseline for further development in building smart in OGC. We also defined the IFC extensions already, and currently having prototypes from those parties that are involved, trying to demonstrate alignment exchanges together with terrain and together with georeferencing. So we can also bring in, like for example, maps, as you can see below. This is ongoing work, which should be completed with a first report by December. But so far, I think we were able to prove that the alignment information captured in IFC now is sufficient, it is precise, and we can always generate these two representation segments and VPIs. So this brings me to more let go to the outlook. What would come next? After having defined the alignment, I think the next big development will definitely be road constructions or roads. Following this alignment, then adding definitions like cross sections, but also the 3D volumes of road surfaces, substructures, curbs, and so on. Having, in order to answer some of this information questions, like getting volumes for quantities, getting material information for purchases, and so on. We know that we have to expand quite a lot into classifications, maybe looking into some modern means to define it, like linked data and so on. Roads will certainly be the next work for 2015. And looking into roads, I think it's not a big derivation to also consider rails, although I think we're currently talking with different rail organizations and getting more support from them. Let's see, one of the forerunners on this is actually Korea. They have a big Korean development project carried out by KICT, which is the Korean Institute of Construction Technology. They presented it to us, and it's a huge project with a lot of detailed information, and I think one of our tasks for next year is to analyze it and bring also European and American perspectives to that. And again, I think it could also be an invitation to you here in the room, if you are knowledgeable in this area or know people knowledgeable in your regions, to come to Building Smart and work together on it, because we need to also reflect the European angle here. This will be, I think, one of the main parts in for next year. And I think the kickoff of this work will be, I think, 22nd or something in March at the next Building Smart Summit in London. So that could be, for all interested in this, being a key date. Then just briefly, of course, work should also go a bit further than into bridges. And I still believe that bridges are closest to the kind of building philosophy of being vertical. And we have seen already bridge work standardized around IFC, and it, I think it can certainly reuse a lot of the current definitions. So then, trying to stick to my time. There were only two words for the outcome or the prospects. One thing I want to show is very briefly a little video which was done by some work I did with American company Kivit, which what you see there is actually an IFC model which shows a road and a railway, and underneath we will soon see in drainage and so on. So I think the possibilities are there. That is still more on a proxy level. It's mainly geometry with attributes attached, but with all the work we are doing now, I think we should have it as a really true semantic information, also with alignment, with connectivity, with traffic information, and so on. So I think the technology is there. I think we have to explore it just further. And again, I think also when you see this kind of combined approaches, you have a station, you have a platform, and so on, I think the boundaries between the classical disciplines of high-rise and infrastructure is going away here. So I hope you agree that this could be the future. as a standardized approach towards infrastructure work. And I also finally believe that all our work we did over the long time is now reaching a certain level of maturity. I think these two red versions are now either developed in terms of software or the future of building smart developments. And so unless Eve comes, I think we have still some way to go and can utilize this kind of technology. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Thomas. Perfect in time. Is someone having a question for Thomas? Yeah. No? Really? Okay, Thomas. If someone is interested, you said, well, please join Building Smart and let us know, because this is one of the projects in the infrastructure room.
Yeah.
And you've mentioned quite a lot. So you didn't give us an outlook of those other projects, but
right.
Will there be somewhere here in IFC 5 or 6 or?
Okay. So all of the development work towards infrastructure I've shown will be going into IFC 5. We have not yet decided whether it all will have to wait and go into one big chunk, or we have intermediate steps. Like,
is it depending on the funding?
It's both depending on the funding, but also on the kind of strategy setting. But it's probably mainly depending on funding and engagement.
Yes.
Yeah, people.
Okay.
People, yeah.
Of course. So if you are interested, please contact Thomas. Thank you very much, Thomas, again.
Yeah.